Find out what's on TJC. Sign up for our weekly email newsletter at www.tjctv.com.
Welcome to The Salon. On this episode, are pink ribbons the best way to fight breast cancer? The Tea Party's impact on Jewish women, the debate over same-sex wedding announcements in Jewish papers, a campaign against Eshet Chayil, and stuff our mothers say. It's coming up on The Salon.
Hello, my name is Jane Eisner. I'm editor of The Forward and Forward.com. Welcome to The Salon.
And I'm Rachel Sklar, editor-at-large at Mediaite.com.
Well, Rachel, we have a wonderful group of women joining us today. Nadine Epstein is the editor and publisher of Moment magazine, about to celebrate its 35th anniversary, quite an accomplishment. Irene Carmon is a reporter for Jezebel.com and is really making quite a name for herself at a young age. And Carol Engel, who's the editor most recently of The Women Who Reconstructed American Jewish Education. She's the Bernard Heller Professor of Jewish Education at the Jewish Theological Seminary. So Rachel, the holidays now are finally over. It's almost election time. How do you deal with all this as a Canadian?
I enjoy the theater of it. I thought that after the 2008 election, it could not get any weirder, but that was before the Tea Party, Sarah Palin 2.0, Christine O'Donnell. So it's pretty decent theater.
Well, so you mentioned some of these women, the Mama Grizzlies of our new political landscape. It's been an interesting challenge, isn't it, to those of us who think of ourselves as feminists, to see women of a very different sort, people who oftentimes identify themselves as very Christian, and certainly espouse views that might be different than the traditional liberal feminist views. I mean, what do we make of this new brand of women politician?
Well, I think on the surface of it, we should be happy that women are entering the conversation, the political conversation. That said, we're talking about a small number of women who have very extreme positions and who aren't necessarily pushing policies that would help women. I mean, I think they really need to be evaluated on the basis of their policies rather than just the fact that they're women. And in fact, it seems like, based on prognostications, the number of women in Congress might actually go down regardless of these women. So really what's going to happen, we're seeing a cynical ploy on the part of the Republican Party to try to claim the mantle of feminism without actually thinking about what it stands for, what its values are.
Right, just standing on the shoulders of Hillary Clinton and saying, oh look, 18,000 cracks in the ceiling, poke.
It's not enough to just be a woman. You also have to help other women in policies, everything from Equal Pay Act to abortion policies to support for rape victims. And I think each one of these candidates needs to be evaluated on that basis and not just about whether they're a man or a woman.
And I would also hope that we wouldn't be single issue voters either, that we also ought to look at what they're thinking about in terms of helping the poor and the unemployed and the underprivileged, and the fact that they have, you know, ovaries isn't enough for me.
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's a good moment to think about what those of us who consider ourselves progressives can do to support women on our side, whether that, you know, why. Is it just PR, or is it easier for a woman to succeed as a candidate if she happens to be an extremist on those positions, because that's not threatening to the status quo? You have these women who, in many ways, are very traditional, in all except for the fact that they happen to be running for office, and that's something that not a lot of women do.
But when we say all this, do we run the risk of narrowly identifying what it means to be a feminist, which is that saying you only can call yourself a feminist if you espouse policies that have been sort of generally campaigned and championed by the Democratic Party or a certain part of the Democratic Party?
That's what's complicated about it, because who gets to define it? Who gets to call themselves a feminist? You know, I tend to go by the metric that Arin's talking about, which is it good for women? And are they looking not only for the good of the woman they are, but all women? And, you know, is it a sisterhood thing?
In their opinion, they believe what they're doing is good for women.
And, you know, that's really important. We can't forget that.
But it's interesting that they want so badly to be called feminists. I mean, to me, this is I'm sure that you'll agree with me, this is a word that has been vilified so much. So to all of a sudden say Sarah Palin and people like her saying, I'm inspired by Hillary Clinton's example in this sort of vague way, and who stole feminism, I'm taking feminism back. So it's an opportunity for us to say, you know, feminism means something. It's not just this word that you can throw around, and that's great that you want to be part of it, but there's an existing context, an existing conversation. You didn't just wake up one day and say this. You know, we can draw you into that conversation, we can talk about what it means, but they're not actually engaging in that broader conversation. They're just throwing the word out.
Well, I think there's always been these two different causes, hasn't there been? Women should be allowed to enter any field that we want to and try to succeed. There's that part. And then there's the second part of saying, how are we going to use that newfound power to help change society? I remember many years ago, I'm dating myself, but I was a foreign correspondent covering Margaret Thatcher in the UK. She sure was one strong woman. She was also the only woman in her cabinet. It wasn't her brand of leadership to bring in other women. And that was a really interesting moment there for me, anyhow, to see that, because I really applauded her in many ways for doing what she did. And yet, it was not at all part of her agenda to help other women or children.
Golda Meir was tarred with the same brush.
Well, I think that was generational. It's just interesting to see how this next generation happens.
But the bigger question isn't just, is the Tea Party good for women, but, you know, is it good for anyone? And that's really, it's really important. I mean, here it's first of all taking by having this fringe group get so much attention in the media, it's basically taking up all the political air, and it's preventing real discussions from occurring that might help women. You know, and it's really about people who are absolutists. My son, who's 18, went to the Glenn Beck rally. And he talked
our
to lots.
Sympathies.
he found it fascinating.
He just went to see what it was like.
He went to see what it was like, and he wanted to meet the people, and he wanted to see what they were like, and not just how they were perceived on television. Mm-hmm. And so he went, and he spoke to people, and he came back, and he said, actually, they were really nice, but they were absolutists. But they weren't people who were toting guns, and they weren't people who were talking about real ideas. He was shocked. They were people who were going to pray for him. They weren't people who were really taking action in the way we would consider taking action. And I thought it was a great lesson for him, and it was a great lesson for me.
But they're taking some action because they're voting, right? We've got Tea Party candidates.
Right.
We have major party nominees.
Yes. It's, you know, really we'll see what kind of, you know, votes they bring in. You know, right now, I think that they really are a chaotic fringe group. And I think we need to remember that, and when we're talking about them, by all this conversation, we're making them even more than they are.
Well, it's great for page views.
Right, but yes. On the other hand, they are a fringe group, but they're also one that has managed to have major party nominations in many states. I mean, just think about the state that we're in now. I mean, you know, God willing, Carlo Palladino will be laughed out of town, but it's possible that he won't be, and he managed to, yes, a very small percentage of voters are in the primary, but here we are actually looking at a candidate who is saying extremist, outrageous things.
Right. Homophobic, racist, you know.
Anti-women.
He's appalling, and this is someone who is nominated by the Republican Party. The same with Christine O'Donnell, the same with Joe Miller.
The scary thing about Palladino, though, is for people who are not engaged, for people who just watch headlines or that's all they see are headlines, they're seeing Palladino in every other headline. So if, you know, if the maxim is like it doesn't matter what they say about you as long as they spell your name right, then Palladino's doing very well. And I'm actually curious to see sort of how he rates just in terms of name recognition. So many people will go to the ballot box and will check off the name that sounds familiar. Like, how many of those votes will be for Palladino?
I think that's an example. Palladino's an example of some of the vagaries in this Tea Party movement. Here's a fellow who is a traditionalist. He says, self-proclaimed traditionalist, who has a wife and a mistress and two families. Mm-hmm. How does that
Talk
square?
About living, yeah, walking the walk.
Well, there is no one walk for the Tea Party.
I mean, each candidate has his or her own, you know, world with values, and they're not the same because it is, again, a chaotic group of people, and there is no one platform. And
that's a good point.
But if they drive Jews away from the Republican Party, I'm happy. I mean, it seems like, and it seems like that's what's happening. I mean, the best thing that happened in the 2008 election for Jews' relationship with liberal politics was John McCain nominating Sarah Palin. I mean, I'm sure you guys all had these same conversations. I had a conservative relative saying, okay, now why did you do this to me? Because he was suspicious of Obama's politics on Israel. But what kind of Jew votes for Sarah Palin? I mean, that's a vote for blithe ignorance.
22% of Jews voted for Sarah Palin. So they're out there.
They exist, but that's pretty small. I mean, that's maybe it's
but there's a subsection, a Venn diagram of sort of quite conservative Jews who might watch Fox, let's say, and the version that they see of Sarah Palin is an incredibly sympathetic one where she was vilified by the press, where she was treated as a sex object, you know, but just generally, and where she was, you know, victimized by Katie Couric.
You're absolutely right. So I have a cousin who's in his 90s, and he's become very conservative as he's gotten older, like many other people. And he was actually defending Sarah Palin to me, not based on her ideas, not based on who she was, but based on the fact that she'd been vilified by the liberal media. And that's what I don't know how he voted, but I'm assuming that's what he was voting against.
So if we can just shift the conversation a little bit here, there's been another way of kind of identifying feminism, and that's with caring about breast cancer and breast cancer research and trying to look for
a cure. That was a very smooth segue.
Thank you, Rachel. That's why they pay me the big bucks here at the Jewish Channel. So October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. I know this is something you care a lot about from a personal level as well, and I'm just sort of wondering, though, are we sort of trivializing things by turning everything into a pink ribbon?
I don't think so. I actually think the pink ribbon campaign has been enormous for generating awareness. And, you know, awareness is, you know, the gateway drug to activism. And, you know, you mentioned that I have a personal stake in it. I do. My cousin has the BRCA gene, and she's had breast cancer twice. And I was actually invited to participate in a breast cancer awareness campaign for Estee Lauder in the classic pose. And I said, I'll do it if my cousin can do it with me. And so we did it together. And it was actually a very powerful thing to do. My cousin Suzanne is incredibly strong. She's my age. You know, she got the gene, I didn't. And the quickness, too, with which she said yes to it, I was like, sort of like, do I want to do that?
You were topless?
I went, yes. Well, topless and covered.
Topless and covered.
Modesty, very, very modest. But, you know, all of the like concerns I had about, you know, how it might be perceived, who might tweet about it, who knows what. I mean, really receded in terms of the fundamental importance of it when it all comes down to awareness and fundraising. So, you know, that's I've got a personal stake, but really, who doesn't have a personal stake in breast cancer or cancer? Everybody does at this point.
It's been a remarkably successful campaign. It's the disease that everybody talks about, that everyone knows about. For example, Delta is now will be giving out pink jelly beans. They're giving out pink lemonade. I mean, and there's that whole
other
side to it.
Are they charging for it?
That's
an airline, right?
There is that whole other side to it, how corporations are involved in it.
Well, I have to say, that's what really bothers me. I feel like it's just become commercialized. I feel like it's a way for corporations to look like they're doing something. You have no idea, actually, how much money Delta is raising with that pink lemonade. And where is it going? And what are we expecting to happen?
Well, I want to piggyback on that. I think that breast cancer awareness has to be important, and, you know, kol hakavod, great that everybody is doing this and everyone's wearing pink ribbons, but to make it a substitute for the hard work of thinking about what feminism is where the problem lies. It is not a substitute for working for harder, tough issues that are more ideological in nature. Everybody's got a mother, everybody's got a sister, everyone's got a relative. We all get that. That's terrific. But let's not say, I'm supporting breast cancer research, therefore I am a feminist. That's where I think the problem lies.
Well, and I think there's another problem too, which is I think it raises expectations that somehow or another, if we just put on another race or buy another pink jelly bean, that we'll raise enough money and a cure will be around the corner. Now, I'm married to an oncologist who's spending his life trying to develop drugs to deal with breast cancer and lung cancer. And I can tell you from Pillow Talk, it's really, really hard. And as a culture, as a society, we're not willing to make the investment. I mean, these are things that take 10, 20 years to develop and test.
And, right, but then when and not positive thinking, you mean?
And not positive thinking. I mean, that's the thing that troubles me. It's sort of like there's this, I'm going to fight this, and the implication is if I lose my fight, then it's my fault. And it's not. I mean, this is a virulent and very mysterious disease that can't just be overcome by willpower.
Well, I don't think that's, I've never thought that that was the suggestion. I really do think that awareness is a gateway drug to action. And, you know, awareness, you know, micro donations, major donations, doing things, organizing campaigns. I mean, that's how you're drawn into it. And you can't expect everyone to rise to the challenge. What you can do is provide an opportunity.
I think one of the most amazing results of this whole Pink Ribbon campaign is the level of acceptance that's occurred, not just in the Jewish world, but everywhere, for women who have lost their hair, for women who have cancer. And I think that that's been a side benefit, and a really powerful side benefit to this whole campaign.
When you mentioned posing with your hands over your breasts, it made me remember this Facebook campaign. In the past couple of years, there have been some controversies around the way that awareness is raised on Facebook for breast cancer. Last year, maybe it was 2 years ago, it was you would put the color of your bra and no one would know. You would just say red and nobody would know what it was, but it was supposed to be raising awareness for breast cancer. This year, you say where you like your handbag, and it's very suggestive. You know, I like it against the wall. And men are supposed to be titillated and confused and then somehow find out about breast cancer, but the link is very weak. And I've been hearing some
Yes,
it's quite weak. So I've been hearing some pushback this week from young feminists saying this is, unfortunately, I think that this is a sort of trickle down or a warping of what you're talking about in terms of getting them through the door.
Because you always have imitators. I mean, any successful campaign will have, you know, imitators.
But it's
that just seems like a really
so
weak.
Sexualized. I mean, what I was going to say is that because we're talking about a breast here, or breasts, and in our culture, you know, that's something that is inherently sexualized by sort of pop culture. Somehow that's been connected, whereas we all know that cancer is not sexy.
Right. Well, for the campaign, emphasis was placed on having sort of being strong, sort of like strong hands, strong everything. It was not, you know, it wasn't like, ooh.
Yeah, it
wasn't
like
at all
it was
like that.
Much more
and it, you know, and you really, I have to say, you really felt it. It was very, it wasn't really sexualized at all. It's pretty empowering to be like, okay, here I am topless in a room full of strangers, like, mm-hmm. Shoot me. Except more like shoot me, and of course, like the fact that I was doing it with my cousin Suzanne, who is a survivor and who's amazing, and she was doing it, and honestly, to see her having fun with it, and not taking it too seriously. Like if she can't, she's got a sense of humor at things. God, I got to.
Somebody proposed an alternative to this Facebook campaign, which is to talk about when you like to do your breast exam, your self-exam. And or just include a link to the American Cancer Society.
Right.
You know,
exactly.
I mean, I think these awareness campaigns have been shown to. I mean, I read a statistic that said that actually the Susan Komen Foundation reported that it had increased interest even after that silly bra color campaign.
I think their Facebook page went wild after the bra campaign.
Yeah.
And they thought it was very successful, and it brought in a lot of people who hadn't been involved before, and that's what they were looking for.
Right.
There's been another interesting controversy when it comes to publications recently, and that has to do with a New Jersey Jewish newspaper that published an announcement of a same-sex marriage between two men, then quickly said, oh no, that was a mistake, we're going to never do that again, then almost as quickly said, well, we might reconsider this. Anyhow, we'll put aside the flip-flopping there, but this really raises an interesting question. You know, is a Jewish community ready to have this kind of discussion on the pages of its publications? What do you think, Nadine?
As the editor and publisher of a magazine, I can tell you that you can never please everyone. And a publication like Moment, like Forward, like Standard, it serves the Jewish community in its diversity. You have to be inclusive. I mean, we happen to live in an era where people can express themselves sexually, you know, professionally, in so many ways, and that's an amazing thing when you think about the time that we live in. And as editors and as publishers, this is something that we really want to protect.
Yeah, but you know, Nadine, I think that it really is a philosophical argument about the role of a newspaper. Is a newspaper supposed to represent Jewish reality, or is it supposed to protect ideal norms? And the part of the story that Jane sort of skipped over was that it was the Orthodox community who got enraged and felt that somehow by seeing this photo in print, it would imply that Judaism, whatever that means, supports same-sex unions. Let me state my bona fides right from the beginning. My son is gay. Married first in a Jewish ceremony, then in a civil ceremony. I think that this is terrific. But what happened with the Standard is that it caved in to the pressure of people who said, don't show the world as it is, show the world as we would like it to be.
And these were two very Jewishly involved, very public yes. service oriented couples. I mean, two people who were, in fact, some of the best that our community could represent. I mean, I think this is really a matter of also, since this happened to blow up as a controversy, it's drawn interest outside the community. And when we think about what kind of message we want to send about, you know, there obviously is not one Judaism, but to the outside world, you know, I saw it picked up on a blog that read the comments on the announcement and feel good about Jews, because there were so many people who objected to them backing off in this announcement, and they said, you know, this is not what Jews stand for. We stand for inclusiveness. This is a part of our community that is just as valuable as others. And I mean, given that Carl Palladino made his homophobic comments in front of the Orthodox Jewish community,
oh, yes,
this is
right.
a moment to say this is not what Jews stand for, and they don't get to be the only ones to define what Jews stand for.
Right, and they're the noisiest.
All yeah. Jews stand for.
They can define what they stand for, but I mean, right. if it, right. you know, the publication needs to make a decision with its conscience and not based on...
And there's really only one decision you can make, yeah. is that you, in this day and age, that you publish
right.
that.
Yeah, practically, as a matter of good business, diversity is good business, and a matter of, I mean, you're forward-looking if you're looking at where the population is going and not, you know, 5 years behind.
But they have a lot of economic power, the Orthodox community, on this issue. I mean, they talked about pulling advertisements.
You know, people pull ads for all sorts of reasons, and you have to just live with it.
Right.
You know, a furor will occur, and that's it. Then it's over, and then maybe those ads come back, and maybe they don't.
Right.
But you can't
and
make
you
a decision
also,
based on
off
that.
If you back off on your values, you also risk alienating
your
you know, a
Although,
different kind of market.
I have to say that, you know, I actually read the Orthodox rabbis of that community, I guess it's Teaneck, did actually write a statement about this, about how they explaining their position on it. And in that, it wasn't like it was a cohesive group thinking that we're going to go there and we're going to go talk to the editors at the Standard, you know. And one of the rabbis went and did talk to the editor, but it wasn't like they all got together to do this deliberately. And I think it's important to say, it's all much more complex.
Well, it is, and I think that there's been a lot. There have been rumors promulgated here that haven't actually been held up. I mean, we don't really know why the newspaper changed its views so rapidly. We can
surmise.
We can surmise,
but you know, I'm the kind of journalist that actually likes to make sure
I write
sure
for
that
the web. I surmise all the time. As long as you say you're surmising.
But there are also some interesting stories that came out of this. For example, This one I haven't seen picked up in the press, that some of the more liberal Jews in Teaneck, the conservative Jews in Teaneck, jumped on the opportunity to say how terrible those Orthodox folks were. And then a campaign began, a very small-scale campaign, where somebody whose children had intermarried used the cohesiveness of the liberal community to point out that, you know, you wouldn't put my kid's wedding announcement in the synagogue bulletin.
Well, we you know, the truth is that we draw lines in all sorts of ways. I mean, I remember when the local Jewish newspaper where I grew up didn't publish wedding announcements of intermarrieds. Now it appears, at least from reading them, because I love to read them, and you know, if you can tell a person's religion by their names, which isn't always the case, but still, it appears now that they do. So somewhere along the line, somebody made a decision that that was going to be okay.
Well, I was just going to say that I find it useful in this kind of situation, do a little thought experiment where you sub out, you know, the fact pattern and sub in something else. So, you know, when you think about, let's say, woman, right? Like the Orthodox community not wanting ordained female rabbis or women in positions of power or whatever. You know, if I'm going to react strongly to that and agitate on behalf of equality for women, then I'm going to play that out to other groups. And, you know, that includes gays and lesbians and anybody who isn't getting equal treatment. I am clearly a liberal Jew, but that's how I roll.
So now we have this interesting story from another perspective, and that is there's an anonymous group of an activist group called Jewish Women Watching. And they have taken upon themselves to actually question the Eshet Chayil, the woman of valor prayer that is normally recited or sung by a husband to his wife on Friday evenings as part of the welcoming of Shabbat. What do you think about that, Carol?
It makes me crazy.
What makes you crazy?
Their position. The Jewish women watching.
And why is that?
Because it is one of the few proto-modern texts we have. It portrays a very well-rounded kind of woman who is out there working, and the kinds of work she does are all over the place. She plants, she sows, she goes to market, she can own land from the text, she can have her own business, and she's doing all the traditional things. Here's a good text we have, folks, and it's done at home. It's not talking about the ideal, and it's an opportunity for a man to say, you know, I know that by and large, you're the one who put this meal on the table, and I just want to thank you. Why attack this text? There are people who are not doing right by the Ten Commandments. Are we going around saying we're going to excise the Ten Commandments from the Torah?
Are they saying that they're going to excise them? Because it seemed to me from the website that what they were just trying to do was to call out the dissonance between saying this and the behavior. I thought they were just saying, why don't you listen to what the words are? If the woman is so valuable, why can't she lead a congregation? You know, like, let's actually call upon the meaning of this and not just say it.
Well, but then it's turning it into something that it's not. I mean, as Carol said,
it's a home prayer.
Yeah,
it is. It's not a public prayer. And I think that there's a difference between hypocrisy and inconsistency. Mm-hmm. There can be a person at home who is saying this prayer to his wife, it's not a prayer, it's a blessing. It's a paean of praise to his wife, and maybe treating somebody in his business who's female poorly. That's one story. But to take lines out of context and use them to call attention to the ills of society, I think it's a misuse of a rather good text.
Well, I know Orthodox women who find it very sexist and who won't allow it to be read at their Shabbat tables.
And what's sexist about it? I mean, she's working, She has very strong, the language is very strong. Mm-hmm. It's, she girds her loins. She's Amazonian almost in the text.
I think
for my 50th birthday, I asked that my husband recite it.
And, you know,
that was what I wanted.
I recently heard a cousin recite a eulogy to her mother using it as
I think it's overused. Yeah. I also asked my children, if any rabbi uses Eshet Chayil at my funeral, I'm going to jump out of the coffin and just pull him off the stage.
Right. But right. I think the reason it's overused is because there isn't that much.
Exactly.
I mean, it's a place in which women exist.
Right.
And as you said, a very balanced one.
And a model.
I think it encapsulates an image of a woman from a different era. And there's something about that woman from this different era that still haunts us as feminists, as women of this day. And I think it's incredibly beautiful, but I do think it definitely is from a different time. And maybe we need to write a new one. Maybe we need to recreate it for our time. That would be something wonderful.
Well, I think that would be sort of what Arum was saying before, which is that it exists as what it is in the home, and then you take the values from it and apply them to now, which means that if we're going to talk about it, if this woman can gird her loins at the kitchen table, then she can gird her loins as the president of Federation or, you know, in politics or on the Bima.
But not everything needs to be politicized. And I think
that's
true. If we only look at things through a 21st century lens, then we are losing an incredible
rich heritage. I'm not suggesting to, you know, get rid of it. I mean, I think you appreciate it for what it is, but, you know, it goes back to what you were saying about hypocrisy and consistency. I do think that if we're going to say this is something that we look at as the ideal, then it should be applied consistently.
Actually, as the daughter of a woman who didn't like to cook and didn't like to clean and was a great mom, but spent her time being the executive director of a Jewish community center and not focused on the house, part of me kind of resents the woman of valor. and I do think that it would just be helpful to have something new.
There is a prayer that many women are saying to their husbands.
Oh.
Which is, the flip side. So that's one way to deal with it.
Thank you for bringing in all the money.
No.
Do you know some of the content?
I don't. These are kind of new rituals that are being written. Maybe Vanessa Ox has it in her book. But I think that they are homegrown, just as the Brit Bat or the baby naming for girls grew up kind of organically in the community, and people were doing their own thing.
So maybe there'll be a man of valor for gay couples and a woman of valor for
there you go.
Gay
could
couples,
be.
Right?
There you
could
go.
Be. Maybe we need to collect some of these wonderful new rituals and texts that are out there, and if people have them in their homes, we should be great to share them. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really important that we talk about something silly today as well. On our sisterhood blog on forward.com, we're doing a little takeoff of the new television show that is Stuff My Dad Says, and we are trying to collect stories and anecdotes of stuff my mother has said. And it's actually been really fun just to think about both the silly and profound and hilarious things that our mothers or aunts or sisters or grandmothers or other women in our lives have imparted upon us. And I just wondered if any of you had stories or anecdotes to share.
Well, I will share one not about my mother or my mother-in-law, both of whom liked a good joke but were basically not funny people. But my husband's Bobby was a very funny lady. And she was babysitting for three raucous teenagers who just didn't really want her cooking anymore and wanted to call in for pizza. And she said, "Pizza? Pizza is stuff." It's coming from somebody who was in her late 70s. The tiny little, archetypical Bobby figure.
Yeah. Right.
My mother always seeks a justification for a celebration. She always wants to give gifts, but she always wants to find some kind of occasion, even if it's the most arbitrary occasion. So we'll be sitting at dinner and she'll say, Irin, here's a gift because you've been having a great week at work. Uh-huh. And, to my brother, congratulations on your job, which he's had for 9 months. And that extends to everything. And she always saves everything and preserves everything. So my sister came to pick her up from the airport. And when she came from Israel, and she said, thank you for picking me up from the airport. Just because you picked me up from the airport, I'm going to give you this yogurt from the in-flight meal.
Oh. I'm sure that yogurt was delicious.
She's a smart woman. Boy, she knows how to make a gift out of
five children.
There you go.
My mom actually is more of the straight man.
Yeah.
But she's a great audience. She'll always laugh. I grew up cracking jokes, and it didn't never occur to me that there were people out there who thought women weren't funny or couldn't be funny.
Well, I think women are funny. I think they don't tell jokes as much. And
you didn't meet the 5-year-old Rachel Sklar.
No, I mean, I think I'd hate to generalize because every woman is so different. But generally, women don't come into a room and tell a joke. A group of women get together and they'll tell stories. Or they'll talk about their feelings or about their ideas, but they don't break the ice by telling jokes, and then they don't keep it up. And it's something I actually see every day in my work, because we actually have a caption contest, which Bob Minkoff from The New Yorker draws for us. And we have lots of readers who send in, little captions that they write. And it's mostly men. Mm-hmm. It's fascinating. And, where are those women? Please,
right,
we'd love to have them. Yeah, anyone can enter. You can be Jewish, you can be not Jewish, you can be old, you can be young.
I love those caption contests. I'll enter.
Yes, yeah, and it's almost, if you look at the winners, you'll see that they're almost always men. And so there is something about how, men and women have learned humor in our culture that's caused this. And
I guess so. We have had on this wonderful show some pretty terrific women comedians. So maybe that's starting to change. My mom was an amazing woman, but definitely was identified by having a lot of chutzpah. So I have been thinking about this lately and realized that it may be time for me to tell the wedding dress story, which I don't know that I've told in public. But when I was about to be married, I really could care less about a wedding dress. It just wasn't on my mind. And one day my mom called. I was living in Virginia at the time, and she was in New York. And she said, well, don't tell Mark, my husband-to-be. And then I thought, oh gosh, I better geared myself to something. She says, well, I went to the sale and I bought you a wedding dress. She bought me a wedding dress. And then she said, don't worry, if you don't like it, I'll donate it to the Synagogue Hanukkah Bazaar.
Oh,
and I thought, oh my
dear.
Gosh, here we have oldest daughter marrying nice Jewish doctor. Right. Synagogue Hanukkah Bazaar.
funny. How does this dress look?
Right. It was fine.
And
it
you
was
wore total, the dress.
Of course I wore the dress. I'm like this good little, I was like, okay, Mom, sure, I'll try it on. It cost so little that the alterations cost more. And I wore the dress. She won.
I
can only
great.
Tell you that when my younger sister got married a few years later, she said, I am buying my own dress.
Well, parents cut their teeth on the firstborns.
Yes.
Don't you think that's true?
I am sure.
I'm
girding myself for my. I should send this as a warning to my firstborn. Anyhow,
you've got just the dress.
That's right. Oh no! I'm such a bad shopper. I will definitely let her buy her own. Well, thank you all for joining us. We hope that you will continue this conversation. Look at sisterhood.com for stuff my mother says. I'm Jane Eisner, and on behalf of my co-host, Rachel Sklar, we thank you for joining us.
Please come join us again soon.